Hey everybody, welcome to Jet City. My name is Agent JZ, or Agent JZ, whichever you may choose. And it's time to do Your Questions 71. Okay, first one is by Pavlos Dpeg. And he says, what is the purpose of the bearing cavity vents? I had presumed that the scavenge pump would extract all liquids and gases. Are these vents open to atmosphere? And if so, how does the scavenge pump maintain a low pressure environment within the cavity? Well, the vent is fairly small and it allows the cavity to, what does it do? It allows the cavity to, actually it's not, hang on. Well, hey, change of venue, change of clothes, because this is the next day. We've jumped forward to Sunday because I had to check my facts. I was 90% sure of what I was going to say, but like, it's always a good idea. Check your sources, check your facts to make sure you're 100% sure. Okay, Pavlos Dpeg. This is a diagram that I've stolen out of this book, that book. It's Aircraft Power Plants by Wild and Crows. And let's see. I'll take a picture of a close-up for the end of this. Anyway, this is your basic main bearing, let's say. And this is the bearing sump. The sump is in blue. The seal cavity is in green. So what we have is, this is the oil jet coming from the pressure pump, spraying onto the bearing, and it's flying everywhere inside the sump. And then it's draining, usually by gravity. Most of the time the airplane is upright. Sometimes the oil can go all over the place. It's a lot of foam and splatter and mayhem happening in there. And it gets to this drain. It's not really a drain because it's actively evacuated or scavenged by a scavenge pump, which is the same thing, just another pump doing a slightly different job. And so it's pulling air and oil out of this cavity. And there is oil coming into this cavity, and this vent allows air to go out or to come in. It's a very small vent. These seals I've drawn as labyrinth seals, but they could be carbon seals, both of which are a static surface and a moving surface trying to seal out oil and air. They do a pretty good job, but not a perfect job. So, around the bearing sump is the seal cavity. Have I drawn this in? Yes, I have. Compressor bleed air coming from usually a fairly forward stage of the compressor. It's not that high pressure. It's fed into the seal cavity, and there are usually labyrinth seals. They're meant to seal air against the shaft, sealing the whole thing inside. So this area is pressurized, and so air leaks out of it there, and leaks out of it into the bearing sump. A very small amount of air leaks in. The reason it's done like that is so that any oil that leaks from the bearing sump, well, it's not going to leak out. It will be there. Any leakage of the seals will be inward of the air rather than outward of the oil. So it preserves the oil. This also acts a little bit like a bubble chamber or an air oil separator, slightly. Air leakage tends to go out the vent, and oil leakage or oil residue, oil splatter from the bearing tends to go down to the scavenge pump. Okay. Sometimes these vents, there's an orifice placed on them, a very small orifice during testing to test the efficacy or the efficiency of the scavenge pump. I don't know if the orifices are there on the aircraft. So I don't know if these scavengers or these cavities, the bearing sumps, I don't know if the scavenge pumps pull a slight vacuum in the bearing sumps in the engine in the aircraft, but sometimes they do in testing because we put a small orifice there. This diagram is a very poor handmade copy of the excellent diagrams you'll find in this book. So this is an unpaid commercial or advertisement for this book. It's another one that's the same size, same weight, by the way, is Aircraft Gas Turbine Power Plants by Jeppesen. I recommend you get both of them because every time you get a textbook, it's written by people and they all have their own sort of ways of looking at things. And if you take one, you get that person or those, I guess, two authors' view. If you take two books or three books or four books, you get a more general idea of what's going on because you look at the situation, the problem, or the device from several slightly different points of view. And you will get a better understanding of everything in this book if you read this book as well as another one. But everything you want to know, everything that you guys have ever asked me is in these books. And they're available online. It says right here, also available as an ebook. Look at that, eh? Okay, so that's our answer to question one. Now, let's go back to Saturday. Second question's by John Dixon. I went to school with a guy named John Dixon, maybe that's you. What is the difference between a scavenge pump and a pressure pump in an oil system? Is a pressure pump gravity fed and a scavenge pump pulls oil from supply and not pressurize the output? The actual mechanism, the pump, the construction of the pump is exactly the same. It's an oil pump, a hydraulic pump or an oil pump, whatever you want to call it. It's the way they're used. A pressure pump takes oil at low pressure from the reservoir and it's often gravity fed. It is, or it's immersed in the reservoir, and it supplies oil to the pressurized side of the lubrication system. So the oil travels to oil jets where it's squirted on gears or on bearings. It's the clean, pressurized supply of oil to the engine. Now the exact same pump, usually at a larger capacity, a larger size or a larger pump rate, is then attached to draw off the oil that has been sprayed on the bearing or the gears, drains to the bottom of a small cavity or a sump, and then that sump is evacuated by the scavenge pump and is returned to the reservoir. The reason it's larger than the pressure pump is because the oil that it's pumping is going to be sometimes foamy, sometimes intermittent. There's a mixture of air and oil, so you want to make sure that the oil or the foam or the mayhem doesn't build up in the sump. So the scavenge pump is always bigger, and because they're always pumping a combination of oil and air, they're fine. They don't care if they get air in them. Typically, in an engine, the capacity of a big engine like this, Rolls-Royce Avon, the pressure pump would be around 3 gallons per minute, and the combination of several scavenge pumps for the different bearing sumps would be 7 or 8 or 10 gallons per minute. So the scavenge pumps are exactly the same thing, they're just being used in a different way. So that's an interesting question, a good question, and an interesting answer, I hope, to you. Okay, number three, Kowalski Elba says, currently I'm doing research about the compressor and turbine blades wear and materials. I'm now using the Rolls-Royce book 5th edition, the one I have. I want to know the materials used these days for manufacturing the blades, nickel or titanium superalloys. Do you recommend any reference or book that I can find what I'm looking for? I don't know any specific books, but you'll find them on metallurgy and manufacturing, sometimes in gas turbine books. But this is I put this question in this video for one specific reason. You said titanium superalloys. There's no such thing. There may be such thing, but not in turbine blades. Titanium is flammable, it's soft, and it's weak compared to steel. It's got a low melting temperature. It actually catches fire before it melts. It's very bad at transferring heat. It's harder than aluminum, and it's stronger than aluminum, and it's heavier than aluminum. It's softer than steel, it's weaker than steel, and it's lighter than steel. A lot of people say titanium when they mean titanium nitride. And titanium nitride is not an alloy, it's a compound. It's titanium chemically reacted with nitrogen, and it's a very hard coating. So you could call it a super high performance coating, but it's not a super alloy. There aren't any turbine blades in combustion turbines, things that burn fuel and send the exhaust gases through a turbine. None of those turbine blades in any engine that I'm aware of anywhere ever have been made of anything containing mostly titanium or even half titanium. There may be a small amount of titanium as an alloying agent, which is like a spice to your dish, 1 or 2%, but not that I know of. The aluminum blades that are the titanium first stage blades in the Rolls-Royce Avon are made of 6% aluminum, 4% vanadium, and the rest of it is titanium. So that's a typical titanium alloy. Titanium is used for compressor blades in high performance engines. It's got better heat, a better temperature tolerance than aluminum, because aluminum is very soft and very meltable. And it's tougher. So titanium is used in compressors, but not in turbines. Turbine blades are usually something like Inconel. Inconel is a high performance alloy, and it contains a lot of nickel and some copper and other things. Another very similar alloy is called Monel, also a lot of nickel. That's what turbine blades are made of, because not only does it have a high melting point, but it's got the characteristic where it maintains its strength to very high temperatures. It doesn't soften and stretch. And turbine blades run hot, and nickel's heavy, so they're under a lot of stress. You could make turbine blades out of steel, but then you'd have to either run them very, very cool, so not very fast and with not much pressure and not much heat from the exhaust, or you'd have to spend a huge amount of compressor bleed air to cool them. So a steel turbine would be very, very low performance. Nickel alloy seems to be the best solution. That's all I can tell you. But there are no titanium turbine blades. And as I've said before in my video called eBay Blades, if somebody's selling a titanium turbine blade on eBay or anywhere, they probably mean a titanium turbine blade. When they say turbine, they mean turbine engine. This is not a turbine. This is not a Rolls-Royce Avon turbine. This is a Rolls-Royce Avon turbine engine. It's just like saying the engine in your Honda Civic is a piston. See my piston? Look at my piston. My piston can really go. No, it's a piston engine. It's a small difference in terminology, but it really makes a big difference. Okay, enough of my ranting. Let's get on to question number 4. Okay. Question number 4. Hey, Agent Jay-Z, would you happen to know anything about the Rolls-Royce Avon AVPIN starter and how that compares to the air start of the J79? I guess it just burns isopropyl nitrate and passes the gas through a turbine, but any more details would be appreciated. Well, that's pretty much it. We are going to use an air turbine starter on this, and that takes air at a couple hundred degrees through a turbine, which that turbine could certainly be made of titanium, but it's not. It's made of aluminum alloy, because it's not combustion gases. It's compressor bleed air. It's 200 or 300 degrees Fahrenheit. And it turns a shaft, which turns a small gearbox inside this nose at a ratio of about 1 to 3 or 3 to 1. So 3 times the revolution of the starter, or 1/3 the revolution of the starter, equals the rotation of the main shaft, brings it up to speed, then we can light the engine. The AVPIN does use combustion gases, passes it through a turbine, and then maybe it's not a turbine, it might be just a plate. I've seen diagrams of it where there's a plate of a steel and there's a geared center on the plate, and it travels down a spiral shaft, and it pushes that plate just once really hard, and it's geared up so that the engine itself turns at a higher rate of speed than the central shaft of the starter. So it pushes really hard. It pushes, takes about a second to just slam it down, and the engine zings up to 800 RPM in less than a second. The AVPIN must be the name of the fuel of this combustion starter. It's like a cartridge, and it makes a lot of smoke, and you can see one of these in action. I actually don't know the name of the video, but you'll search. You're a YouTuber, a YouTube fan, a YouTube viewer, and it's a Rolls-Royce Avon, one of these, in a Canberra bomber, and they start it up. And you'll see that they hit the button or they flip the switch or whatever they do, and there's a huge amount of black smoke in about 1 second, and you can hear the engine go from nothing to starting RPM in 1 second. It's very impressive. I think the smoke is fairly toxic, and the starter itself needs a lot of maintenance. It was designed to allow the aircraft to start themselves wherever they were, no matter anywhere in the world they happened to fly or where they were. So it was great, but it turns out that most airports have starting facilities, and your Canberra bomber can't land anywhere but an airport unless it's crashing. So that's all I know about AVPIN starters. Question 4 about the Avon AVPIN starter was by Ika Laukkanen. Now, number 5 is by James Banana. James Banana. This is the first video I watched from this channel. Kinda got stuck here and watched all of them except for the test. He's talking about JetTech Lockwire, which is one of my very few videos that's meant for actually training purposes. If you want to learn how to lockwire, I recommend it. But he goes, except for the tests. This channel started with an engine test. When we start up this Avon, 20,000 horsepower, and we run it, it's kind of my raison d'etre. It's running a jet engine. It's cool, isn't it? It's I guess it's called gearhead porn is what it's been called by some people. So I recommend James Banana that you go and look at some of the videos of Avons and Spays and Olympus engines running, and J79s and LM1500s and Arenda Type 10s, Type 14s, industrial engines. We've got a Solar and the AI-25 Russian turbofan. It's a little one, but it's a cool engine. So I recommend all of those. If they don't get you excited, I can't help you. This is not the right channel for you. Yeah. So our final question is by DodgeMan789. He has a question that's actually fairly common. He says, I was wondering about turbine engines that power helicopters and turboprop planes. If you had the right exhaust nozzle on them, would they produce sufficient thrust to drive a small plane or something else smaller like a small jet drag car? Well, when you use the word sufficient, I would have to say no. This engine in its aircraft form produces 10,000 pounds of thrust. It's a 20,000 horsepower engine. So when it's hooked up to a power turbine, like a helicopter engine or a turboprop, it produces a massive amount of mechanical power. This would be equal to the size of the most powerful aircraft turboprop engine ever made. And this is a relatively medium-powered gas generator. So the helicopter engines are typically between 400 and a couple thousand horsepower. Turboprops are the same. They're between 400 and 5,000-7,000 horsepower. After that, I don't know what. I guess after that, propellers aren't needed to be that powerful, because once you get to that size of an aircraft and an engine, a turbofan is more efficient and they can go faster. Now, with the T-58, for example, it's a 1,300-1,400 horsepower engine. So the gas generator exhaust is extremely high speed. So unless you have a plane that's the size of a motorcycle and wants to go 600 or 700 miles an hour, the engine's exhaust gases are leaving too quickly, and the overall power of the engine it's not high enough to make a decent sized airplane go that fast. So you could put 4 T-58s on the wings of a very small aircraft and have them work as turbojets, and it would go fast, and it would be very fuel inefficient, because as I've explained before, the speed of the exhaust gases compared to the speed of the plane, if there's a big difference there, you're wasting a lot of efficiency. What you want is the air coming out the back of your engine, the exhaust gases, the total airflow coming out the back of your engine, to be very close to the design speed of your aircraft. That makes it very efficient. And that's the case with modern large airliners. So, for a go-kart, if you took a T-58 at 1,300 horsepower and you made it act as a turbo jet, you would have a very fast go-kart that would accelerate very slowly, because it would be like the go-kart is stuck in top gear. It would be better to use the T58 with its power turbine, with its torque coming out the output shaft at 6,000 RPM and 1,000 foot-pounds of torque. That won't just make a go-kart go really fast, that'll really make a truck get up and leave. So that's the reason they put that gas generator onto a power turbine, to essentially, in a manner of speaking, it gears it down, it gives it more of a positive push, positive purchase on whatever it's trying to do. The turbine is better at extracting power and making it into mechanical power than is a jet just squirting out the exhaust gases out the back of the engine. So some people have done this project. I haven't got a lot of feedback back from them on how successful it is. But if you really want to make a turbojet out of a turboprop or a turboshaft engine, it's my belief that you're going backwards. It's better to use the mechanical output of the power turbine to do whatever you want it to do. For example, mounting a T58 as a, hey, the race boats go 150 miles an hour on water. If you converted a T58 to a turbojet and stuck it on the back of one of those boats, I doubt if they would ever hit 150 miles an hour, because the friction between the screaming 1,000 mile an hour exhaust and the air, is it creates a great deal of noise and turbulence. It doesn't transfer the power to make the vehicle go as well as the water jet being powered by the power turbine. So if you want to prove me wrong, build one and I'll come video it. It'll be great. But that would be a thrust boat, and a pure thrust boat is not very efficient. It's also not legal for competition. I'm not sure if anybody's ever built one, but I'm sure I'll hear from the experts out there. So from a 90% connected Rolls-Royce Avon in our test cell, on a Saturday. Thanks for watching.